If you have any questions, inshallah ta'ala. Abu Talib, regards to Abu Talib, يعني تلك الأمة قد خلت. نعم أبو طالب. No, I said تلك الأمة قد خلت. Allah tells in the Quran تلك الأمة قد خلت لها ما كسبت ولكم ما كسبتم. That is the people who were dead. They will get whatever they've earned, and you, we, will get whatever we have earned. There are multiple ahadith which speak about Abu Talib, and the ulama are in difference of opinion. With the vast majority of the ulama on the opinion that Abu Talib naja, Abu Talib is yani died as a believer.
Opposite, most of the ulama think that Abu Talib died really mushrik.
No.
And at least his punishment on the day of judgment will be Abu Talib and will be like a sort of fire on his soul and his brain will be boiled.
Sahih. And the hadith is sahih. The hadith is sahih that Abu Talib will be placed in yani the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said yani dhahiyat min an-nar, which means the shallow waters of the hellfire, he be placed in, such that the hellfire will come up to his ankles, which will make his brains boil. Okay, that hadith sahih. But what does that hadith mean? Is that hadith what a proof of his shirk? Okay, I mean, if you want a proof of his shirk, show us him as a mushrik. That's the only way you can have qata' of his shirk. The only way you can be absolutely sure of his shirk, show us him yani declaring loyalty to Hubal or to Manat or Al-Uzza. Show us the loyalty to that. You're not going to find any loyalty to that. Okay? That's the first. So what did it, those ulama who say that, well, what does the hadith mean? They say that the hadith which speaks about the punishment of Abu Talib is a very clear, yani, they say it's actually a proof for, not against, because that punishment is the punishment of Jahannam. Okay, that there are seven darakats of hell. The lowest darakat, descending level of hell, what I mean the lowest, it's the highest, the least punishment, is called Jahannam. And that darakat of hell is reserved for disobedient believers.
I don't want to argue more than that.
Okay, I mean, it's not an argument. I don't think we can...
Jahannam in the Quran is Jahannam, so it's not the... There are seven gates for Jahannam. There are different levels, but Jahannam in the Quran, you cannot say Jahannam is part of Jahannam. Jahannam is Jahannam.
What does Jahannam is Jahannam mean? Jahannam
is fire, mean? And
hellfire. Jahannam is which?
But Jahannam in Arabic.
What is Jahannam? Is Jahannam even an Arabic word?
Yeah, what it is.
Is it an Arabic word?
Yes.
No, it's not. It's a Persian word. So,
what is in the Quran? What it means?
Jahannam is Gahannam. It has no translation. It's a word which musta'arab comes from the Persian language. Yeah, and Jahannam, if you open up books of Islamic belief, aqidah, you will see that Jahannam is the lowest of the seven darakat of hell. And that Jahannam, inshallah ta'ala, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open us up and to allow us to understand the religion. Ameen. So Jahannam is the lowest rank of hellfire. It's the hellfire in the hadith, that is going to be completely free of those who are punished. I think you should let me finish. That's what's called adab. Yani is that if the lowest level of hellfire, where what? Eventually all, even Ibn Taymiyyah, Ahmed Ibn Taymiyyah mentions it, that all of the, it's gonna be free of any type of person who's been punished in it, and such that greenish foliage is going to grow upon Jahannam. It's well known, so what we're going to do is open up the books of our tradition and you will see Jahannam described. Jahannam is not lava, Jahannam is not sa'ir. There are multiple different levels of what? Of hellfire. Okay? That's the nature of what it is. So Abu Talib is something, what we say, that there's something which is a difference of opinion upon it. Difference of opinion. What does a difference of opinion mean? There are those ulama who said Abu Talib died as a mushrik and is going to hell. That's a call from amongst what the corpus of the statements of our religion, khalas. Likewise, there are those who are of the opinion, and they are the majority who are of the opinion, that Abu Talib did not die as a mushrik, because we have zero evidence Yani what's called qat'i, absolute evidence to say he was a mushrik. In fact, we have the opposite. We have the statement of Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib, where the Prophet on his deathbed is saying, say a word that I will guarantee your safety in the hereafter. And then the Prophet, as he walks back, Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib turns to the Prophet and said, qalaha. He said it. And then the Prophet says to Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib, I didn't hear it. Okay, that's the hadith sahih. Now what we ask is that is the security of Abu Talib upon the Prophet ﷺ hearing it? I mean, does the Prophet have to hear Abu Talib's profession of shahada in order for Abu Talib to be saved? La, otherwise each and every single one of us would be damned. Every one of us would be damned. Has he heard our profession? You see, in the same, has he heard our profession? So Abbas, who's a believer, I heard him say it. The Prophet ﷺ said, I didn't hear him. There's a multiple tradition, and that's why the ulama have gone to different opinions upon it. And what they tell us in our religion, لا إنكار لمختلفي, nobody can stand and accuse others of being wrong when the ulama have disagreed. That's a principle of religion. And it's conclusive. And subhanAllah, I wish I did for the Prophet Sata what Abu Talib did for them. I wish. And that's why people who are going to, if you believe that, at least hold your tongue in adab. Because what have you did for the Prophet ﷺ? Tell us what you have did. That's somebody who risked life, reputation, to protect his dear nephew. SubhanAllah. You see this, and Allah Ta'ala, if we're going to see people on the face of the earth who do for the religion of the Prophet ﷺ, what Abu Talib did. That's why the year he died is called the year of grief. That's what it's called, the year of grief. That was one of the most painful things that ever happened in the life of the Prophet ﷺ when his dear uncle Abu Talib died. And so Allah Ta'ala alim. And then we all stand before Allah with our opinions. Let's just hope that our opinions can cave with the religion. Can one pray behind someone who openly declares Abu Talib as mushrik? And of course you can, that's what you just said. It is neither here nor there. Yani, what do you mean neither here nor there? You take your opinion and hope that what you stand in good faith with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But whatever opinion you hold, you must have adab with that opinion. Must have adab. And especially if you hold an opinion against. If you hold an opinion against. Okay? And remember, great people have held opinions against. From the likes of the great people who held opinions against. I'd like to Imam Nawawi. What are you going to say about it? Can you pray behind Imam Nawawi? Yahya Sharafuddin al-Nawawi radiallahu ta'ala, and who had an opinion against. But you don't see Imam Nawawi writing books and standing on the minbar and declaring that they're all in hellfire, do you? That's an opinion that one of the great mushtahids of this ummah came to, al-ilm, based upon knowledge, female dhahara lahu, in that which manifested to him. Full stop, yani. So it's not an issue, can you pray behind it? It's not something that what renders somebody's aqidah batil, for or against. Okay? So, any further questions, inshallah ta'ala?